Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Revelation is an exciting book, and yet at the same time, it's a terrifying book. And it depends on what side you're on. If you're on the Lord's side, then it's quite fascinating. And it's really not that we ought to have these kinds of thoughts, but you know, a lot of people are wondering. They see the injustices that go on in the world, and they think, you know, it's not right. Well, just like the principle of sowing reaping, God is not mocked. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. And we don't always reap the same day we sow, but there is a sowing that takes place all through the course of someone's life, and then there'll be a reaping at some point. And for those that wonder, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, don't worry. This is the worst it ever gets for us. But on the other hand, those that reject Christ, they haven't even begun to see the sorrows that are going to come upon them, not only at this time, but also throughout all eternity. And so I'm glad, as the song says, I'm glad I'm on the winning side. Amen. Revelation chapter 20. Last week we were looking at, and as you recall, I was preaching on the resurrections and more. And I never got to the more. Matter of fact, I don't even think I'm going to finish the more today. But so there'll be more. I'm trying to figure out what I'll call the next message. I think I already come up with still more. You know, I don't know what that does for anyone that would see the title. You know, what's this movie about, this message about more? People probably tune it. They'll watch that thing. They'll listen to that thing like crazy. Maybe not. But we finished, in a sense. Actually, a friend of mine had spoken to me about it, and you get into some heavy conversations sometimes about the goings on that are going to take place. But basically, in a nutshell, that first resurrection is broken down into three sections. You've got the first fruits, which was Jesus, his resurrection in Matthew 27:51-53 there. And then you have the harvest, which is the main body, which will take place at the rapture of the church, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13-18, and again in 1 Corinthians 15. And that's what we were using as a text where we're talking about the resurrections and the order thereof. But then there's the gleanings, and the gleanings take place in the book of Revelation as God is, through the tribulation period, he is still going to rescue, if you will, those. He's not going to appoint them under wrath that have come to him as well. And so that we read in Revelation chapter 20. Let me just back up and read it again. It says in verse number 5, but the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. And so God gives a description of what that is. It's a three-part happening there. And then after that, well, there's a terrible occurrence that takes place, a foolish one, actually, if you think about it. And let me just briefly read what it says there. It says that blessed and holy is he that hath the part in the first resurrection. We talked about the parts, 1, 2, and 3. On such, the second death hath no power. So what, if you're not part of that first resurrection, what awaits you is the second death. And that will encompass the second resurrection, which is what we're going to talk about here in just a little bit. He said, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are expired, that's the millennium. There's people that don't even believe that one exists. But if you read all the verses in Revelation 20, I believe it's 6 times where 1,000 years is mentioned. You've got to be blind as a bat to not see that there's a 1,000-year reign that's going to take place. It's mentioned enough times there. But it says, and when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. So he's going to be locked up. So for all the people that through the different dispensations that want to say the devil made me do it, well, for 1,000 years, God's going to lock up the devil, and there isn't going to be any devil making anybody do anything. Through all the dispensations, God is eliminating man's excuses for why he won't come to Christ. That's why the time to do it is right now, where it's a free gift of God. I mean, how much more simple could God make it? It's a free gift of God. It's a gift. Here, take it. And people still refuse to do so. But he says that when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations. He's a deceiver, Revelation 12. And he doesn't have to change his tactics. He's batting 1,000. The only time that the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, which he began using on Adam and Eve back in the garden, did not work is in the temptation of Jesus Christ in the wilderness. Other than that, every one of us saps have fallen for it. And so he comes forth and he's going to deceive, no doubt the same way he always has. Deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog. This isn't the Gog and Magog mentioned back in Ezekiel 38 and 39, but it's representative of the spiritual leadership, Satan in particular, and all the nations that are going to come up at this point. It says, and they went up on the breath of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city, Jerusalem, even though it's earlier called, I believe back in Revelation 11, it's called spiritually Sodom. What a great place, right? But he calls it that beloved city, and it is, because it's the city of peace, it's the city of God, and he says they're going to compass that. And at that point, God's done fooling around with this world and with the forces thereof. And he's not going to give the devil a toehold for any time. And it says there, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. You talk about it. You know, people still brag to this day about Israel's six-day war. God's got that beat. This isn't going to go on for about an hour. It's going to be done. And at that point, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are. They got tossed in 1,000 years prior to that. They were there when that'll take place. They're going to be there for all of eternity. Where the beast and the false prophet are and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Do you want to join them? Not me. Not me. I believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and he saved my soul. And again, to rehash last week's message, but he hasn't appointed me under wrath. I believe God. Just as much as God is going to loose Satan out of the place that he said he was going to put him for 1,000 years, and just as surely as he went in there on day one is when he came out. Just like Jesus said, if you want a sign, he said, as Jonah spent 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man spend 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Count on it, folks. He spent 3 days and 3 nights. No foolishness about a fraction of a day and all this. He said 3 days and 3 nights, 3 24-hour periods. And if you don't like that, if you can't understand that, then tough cookies. I believe God. I believe every word that he says. And so you say, well, what are you driving at? I'm driving at the next thing on the calendar at this point is what is commonly referred to as the Great White Throne Judgment. This is the second resurrection. This is what is often referred to as the general resurrection. And that's what most people actually believe in. Most people believe that all of humanity is living lives of different degrees of years. And when they give up the ghost, they go into a holding cell of sorts, waiting for this final general resurrection of everybody. And everyone's going to come up, and they're going to be judged, as it says here, according to their works. That's why people believe that salvation is based upon works. Why? Because the Bible says it right here. But this isn't us. This isn't us. But nonetheless, if you take this and you believe that you're part of that crowd, then you have to come away with the understanding that you will one day, down the road, be judged according to your works. And if you're if you've got more good deeds than bad deeds, then you're in. But however, we would ever, there's no way that we would ever know that. But it doesn't say that in the text. Let me read the text, because the final determining factor has nothing to do with works. John said, I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. What's the determining factor as to whether or not you're going to go into the lake of fire? Have anything to do with works? No, it has to do whether or not your name is written down. And that's the question this morning. Is your name written down? Is your name written down? I want to go back over this this portion that we've just read here in verse 11 to 15. John says, I saw a great white throne. I don't know if he's referring to the magnitude of it, the size of it. All I know is that it's probably enormous. But it says that it's a great white throne. In Isaiah 66 in verse 1, the Bible said, thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Maybe it's just one monstrous, gigantic, enormous throne. I would have to, it's not the same, but I can just remember as a child watching The Wizard of Oz. And when they came in and they were standing before the wizard and they were trying to explain, we were headed down the yellow brick road. And that's what I think a lot of people think they're going to do before God and this great white throne. They're going to offer up all these excuses. And you know what the wizard said? Silence! But we know that the Wizard of Oz, he was a phony. Pay no attention to the man behind that curtain. I got news for you. If you're standing at this judgment, there's no curtain. There's no man behind the curtain. It's him. You'll be standing there alone because that's what he says in the passage. But the key here is that this is going to be huge. To be standing there, notice what it says. From whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. Talk about people don't have a leg to stand on. There's nothing they're going to be stand on. You're going to be suspended in space before God. Nothing to cling to, nothing to grab a hold of, nothing to brace yourself. Everything. No support, no screen, no shield, nothing. Just you and God. It's going to be a frightening day. And notice that there's no rainbow around this throne. You say, why? Well, earlier in Revelation, when you see the throne of God, you see a rainbow. It says in Revelation 4 and verse 3, and he that sat upon was to look upon like jasper and a sardine stone, and there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like an emerald. In Revelation chapter 10, the Bible says in verse 1, "And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head." So there's rainbows, and you know just as well as I do that the rainbow is a covenant promise from God for mercy. Remember back in Genesis 9, in verse 12 to 16, God said, "This is the token of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you. For perpetual generations, I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud, and I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh." God's going to be merciful in the future. "And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember my everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth." I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, you know, maybe that's why the homosexuals of this world have embraced the rainbow. Because somehow in the back of their mind, they're hoping. They're hoping at all costs that at some point, they're going to get some mercy. They're going to get some understanding. They're going to get the idea that somehow what two people do behind closed doors doesn't matter to God or isn't seen by God. But God called that behavior an abomination. It's an abomination to God then. I read something on Facebook the other day. Someone said that the homosexuals were looking for, I don't know if they were looking for, but somebody was looking for, the learning institutions were looking to teach about homosexuality in the schools or institutions of higher learning. And I remember seeing the response. They said, "Okay, let's do that. Let's start with Sodom and Gomorrah." I thought, yeah, there you go. You know, you want to teach about it? Go ahead. Anyway, the earth and the heaven fled away. The earth and the heaven fled away. We don't see a new heaven and a new earth until Revelation 21:1. So all of these individuals are just going to be dangling out in space. Nothing for them. And it says for them, so it's got to be the individuals that are mentioned in verses 12 and 13. In verse number 12, it says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books according to their works." The dead here constitute the second resurrection. You do not want to be, if you're here right now, you don't want to be a part of this. You don't want to be a part of it. Everyone that comes up in the first resurrection is said to have come up in the resurrection of life. And we saw that described, I read the verses last week, in John 5 and verse 29. It says, "And ye shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation." There's two separate resurrections. Again, to reiterate what I said last week, the two resurrections, the first resurrection has three parts. The first fruits, the harvest, and the gleanings. Jesus at his resurrection, we at the rapture of the church, I hope we'll be a part of that. There's no telling when it's going to occur. It could happen. But if it doesn't, I'm not worried about it because I'm in Christ. And then the tribulation period, which I am not going through the tribulation. You say, how do you know that? Because God said he hasn't appointed me under wrath. And that period of time is called the wrath of God. And so if you want to go through it, as I said last week, help yourself. I hope God gives you your wish. 2 Timothy 4 and verse number 1 says, "I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick." Quick means alive. "The quick and the dead." Two separate ones. This is the resurrection of the dead. And that dead is going to be a reference to, number one, it's going to be a reference to those mentioned in Ephesians 2 in verse number 1. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. So he's going to resurrect all of them. John 5:24 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath, present tense, hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Glory to God. I'm part of that. I just believe God. Angels are also going to be a part of this. God, according to Jude, verse number 6, the angels which kept not their first estate, that's going back to Genesis chapter 6, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness until the judgment of the great day. That's that day right here. And so the angels that kept not their first estate, this is where they're going to be judged as well. I'm not saying that this isn't going to be a colossal judgment day. I'm just saying we're not going to be part of it. Maybe we could be witnesses. You know, I read in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1 saying, see, we're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Well, it appears that right now there's individuals that are witnessing stuff going on. I don't know. Maybe we will witness this. No wonder the Bible talks about tears. Nonetheless, Peter says in 2 Peter 2 and verse 4, for if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. That's the judgment. At this judgment right here, the second resurrection, the great white throne is where the angels that fell are going to be judged. 2 Peter 2:9 says, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. They don't show up at the judgment of the nations in Matthew 25, so I don't know of any other judgment that awaits that the Bible spells out other than this one. So that's where they'll be. Hebrews 9:27 says, but as it is appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. And so if we just break that down a little bit, what we learn from that is that man in general has an appointment with death. Some, as we've mentioned already, some didn't die. Enoch didn't die. He's a type of the church. But others have died and they were resurrected, but they died again. Everyone has an appointment with death. But think about it. If we go out at the rapture of the church, which precedes the tribulation and the millennial reign of Christ, and people's longevity on the earth is going to be enhanced to the point where they're probably living again to, the Bible says a child will die at 100. So with that in mind, there will be people that will be born in the millennium, live their whole lives right to the end of the millennium. When's their judgment? Right here. So if someone has ever told you that the only people that are going to be at the great white throne, at this judgment right here, are just lost people, they're wrong. Because there's some people there who, as we read in verse 15, there's some people there whose names are written in the book of life. So they're obviously not lost. Revelation 11 and verse 17 and 18 said, we give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry, and the wrath is come, and the time of the dead that they should be judged, and that they should give reward unto the servants, the prophet, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. These individuals are saved. I'm really going to upset some people now. I sound like Joe Biden. They won't let me say it. Now I can say it, and I'm going to say it. These people are saved by faith and works, and saved by works in the millennium. Because there won't be any faith. There will be no need of faith in the millennium. Jesus is going to be here. But they're all judged according to their works. The books are opened, and the book of life. Notice that he says here there's two classes of books. Books which contain works, no doubt. Daniel 12 and verse 1 says, "And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book." And of course, that time is a time of Jacob's trouble, Israel. And the main pronouncement of judgment and wrath is going to be, even though it's going to fall upon the earth, it's directed at Israel. For what? Well, for rejecting their Messiah. Malachi 3:16 says, "And they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name." God is recording some things. Exodus 32 and verse 32 and 33, "Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of the book which thou hast written. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book." But there's another book that contains names as well. And these names are names in the age of grace. In Philippians 4:3, they're called fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. And that's a key element here, the book of life, because according to verse 15, if your name is not found in the book of life, you're going to be cast into the lake of fire. So I guess we could ask ourselves this morning, is your name written down? Do you know for certain that it's written down? But there's passages that talk about having people's names blotted out. Are you worried this morning about having your name blotted out? You shouldn't be. Say, why not? He gave us everlasting life. I mean, why do we want to tear apart the Word of God? Everlasting means everlasting. So if he gave you everlasting life, what's the chance of you having your name blotted out? None. It can't happen. Now, I know the daffy people, I'll tell you, no, there's no yeah buts. Either everlasting life is everlasting life and lasts forever, or it doesn't. Like I said, there's passages where people's names are going to be blotted out in the tribulation or in the millennium for works or lack thereof. Revelation 3:5 says, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life." I mean, think about it, folks. If salvation is a free gift of God, and it is to us, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." If that's the case, and it appears it is, right? And that's what you've done, and you received everlasting life, then how, pray tell, are you going to get your name blotted out of the book of life? Maybe those verses aren't talking to you. Oh, that would explain it. "He that overcometh," see, I'm already an overcomer. I'm more than a conqueror through him that loved me. Who is he that overcometh? But he that believeth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Anyway, he said, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. I will blot out his name," or will not blot out his name, "out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before the Father and before his angels." Revelation 22:19 says, "And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in the book. Man, if that's the case, all these new versions, they can't come to an agreement as to what God really said. You know, awful lot of people, if that verse pertains to the church age, awful lot of people are going to go to hell for having done this, getting their name blotted out. But here's a thought. There's only one heavenly book that I know of that's composed of books. That's the Bible. Perhaps it's the Bible itself that's the book of life. I don't know. Just maybe. Just maybe it's the book of life, the Bible, that's going to judge every man. Jesus said in John 5 and verse 39 and 40, "Search the scriptures, for in them you think that you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me, and I will not come to me that you might have life." John 12 and verse 48 says, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." Well, that seems to indicate that the word of God may in fact come up, may be one of those books at the great white throne judgment. Revelation 20 and verse 13 says, "The sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to their works." The sea gave up the dead which were in it. I think there's a difference. I believe there's a difference between the sea and the seas. The sea is talking about the great deep, whereas the seas are the waters on the earth. And I think that there's notice what it says in Psalm 146 in verse 5 and 6. "Happy is he that hath the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, which made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that therein is." Now, if you break that down, if you wanted it to be the bodies of water on the earth, wouldn't you have to say the seas? I would think so. But he doesn't say that. He said, "which made the heaven," singular, "the earth, and the sea." So then you explain it. Revelation 4:6 says, "Before the throne there was a sea of glass, like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind." Revelation 5:13, "And every creature which is in heaven and earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory." See, this sea is not the seas of the earth. We read about in Genesis 1:2, the darkness was upon the face of the deep. The face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved on the face of the waters. I don't want to get into a whole theological discussion of the deep here. But there are plenty of verses that lend itself to that. The great deep is the heavenly body out there in between the earth and the third heaven. And that's the abode of the angels. Should I say this? Oh, why not? I'll say this and I'll stop for today. There is a number of people right now. It's been going on my whole life, but it seems to intensify and subside here and there all the time. But there's always people seeing UFOs. Always seeing it. No one's found one, but they see them. And I learned a long time ago, I don't I don't tell anybody what they see or felt or heard. What do I know? All I know is if whatever someone saw or heard or felt contradicts this book, then God is not the author of it. That much I'll be dogmatic about. But people are seeing things. They're seeing fast-moving lights. And we're supposed to believe that because somebody saw that, and it's unexplained. By the way, what's a UFO? It's an unidentified flying object. Oh, yeah, that's exactly what it is. But see, they would have us believe that, no, unidentified flying objects are little green men from Mars. Well, we've got rovers and everything all over Mars, and they have been for a while. They haven't found a little green man yet. Oh, they must have lived a long time ago. There's always an excuse. But what I know is this. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. And so if there's fast-moving lights around in the heavens, then what we're probably seeing is the sons of God floating around out there, transporting from one place to another, probably doing, since the devil himself is a great deceiver, since we know in Job 1 and 2 that he's constantly making trips up to heaven to accuse the brethren. And so these angels are flying all over the place and probably playing games with us. Because if they could draw us away from God, they will. And if they can get us to believe in something else. Because think about it. What is really the purpose of us trying to find life somewhere else? Because if we find life somewhere else, we can throw this book away, because it's not true. And so there is an underlying reason why people want to disprove this book. But in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I believe it's Psalm 115 that says that the heavens are God's and the earth he's given unto the sons of men. He didn't say the earth and some other place in Alpha Centauri. No. The earth is where man is, and all the rest is just wishful thinking on, who is that guy? Stephen Hawking and others, you know. But I don't know if he believed in that or not. He believed some strange things. But nonetheless, I'll stop right there. But I want to continue with this more, because this is what's going to take place. And I've got to get through this because it's an important subject, because it messes with the doctrines of today. If you don't have this settled and you're transported like John was way out into the future and you see yourself at this judgment, then you don't have everlasting life. You don't. And you would be in danger of losing it at any given time. The only reason why we can even live power-filled, hopeful lives is because we have everlasting life. I don't know how an individual that thinks you can lose it can get up every day and be excited about living for God. You know, when your first order of business stepping out of bed is, oh, I hope I didn't lose it yesterday. No? Yeah. Yeah, can you imagine if every day you thought, as you rolled out of bed, you thought you lost your wallet? What would you do? You'd be spending your whole day looking for your wallet. And then like most times, you know what you do? Oh, it's right here. It's in my pocket the whole time. Well, that's what people are doing, wasting their time. Once you've trusted Christ as your Savior, you've got it. And if you want to run around thinking that you lose it or you've lost it and you're trying to get it back, you're going to waste a whole lot of life and you're going to miss what God wants. He wants us to live life that is abundant. And we can only do that if we know that we're saved.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.